Ajay, thank you for coming on and taking time out of your busy schedule to come on the nursing show. Tell us a little bit about your background and what you do for GE Healthcare.
Sure. First of all, it's a pleasure for me to be on the show. Really excited. With respect to my background, I've been with GE for 9 years. Most of it has been running businesses, different businesses. The most recent one for the last 3 years has been what we call as the primary care ultrasound. This is the value and the super value ultrasound, about $150 million business. Before that, I ran our global anesthesia business. This is probably a $450 million business based out of Madison. Those are the two main things that I've done in GE. Before that, I was running our global GE healthcare pricing function. And you know, all these 9 years, I've been deep in healthcare, which is a very satisfying discipline, if you will.
It definitely is something that's important. And I think a lot of people miss that big companies have individuals like yourself who are committed to good, high quality healthcare and helping people.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that is the mission. You know, if I compare a healthcare business to anything else, you know, businesses go up and down, as you know. But, you know, what is great about healthcare is when you wake up on a Monday morning, irrespective of where the numbers are landing, you're doing something which is worthwhile. And especially in the V-scan business, it's not just for the developed world. I mean, there are very interesting things that we are doing, for example, in Ghana, in Nigeria, in Kenya, in Indonesia, saving lives and making a difference.
So tell us a little bit about what's gone into the development of the V-scan technology, this miniature ultrasound that you all have put out there on the marketplace.
Yeah. Let me show the device to you. So this is
fantastic.
You can see this. You know, it you can hold it in the palm of your hand. You can put it in your pocket if you're a doctor, doctor's pocket. And this is the probe. So it has two parts to the device. One, which is the main electronics, which has the beam forming and the like, and the display. And the other is the probe. And as you know, ultrasound is all about sending ultrasound radiation at predefined frequencies into the human body and interrogating different parts of the body basis what you hear back in some ways. That is the technology. Now, if you look at, you know, look at the size of the device, right? All of us have had some ultrasound, either ourselves or our wives or, moms or whatever, have had ultrasound before. These are huge ultrasound devices that you have to lug in. A lot of that technology we have miniaturized into this this small handset. And this is phenomenal. I mean, clearly the image quality and the size is different compared to your regular console, but a lot of what you can do with those large devices, you can do on the small V-scan. So it's the miniaturization electronics. It is making it reliable and robust. It is making sure that you get the image quality with a lower cost, but a miniaturized product. All of that goes into this innovative device. And the only one thing I would say before I turn it over to you for the next question is, recently we sold 15,000 units of the V-scan, not this, but a modified version of this. And we were asked by the Smithsonian to put that device in a Smithsonian museum.
Wow.
It's so innovative that even the Smithsonian has got wind of it. So we're pretty excited about it.
Well, it is, and it really seems to be one of those devices that can really revolutionize the way we bring healthcare to individuals in smaller communities. You talked about the third world, but there are places here in the United States that are more remote, and people just don't have ultrasound facilities close by. So their primary care doctor or their nurse practitioner, having a device like this would really make a big difference.
Yeah, you're exactly right. You know, if you go back in the medical history, in 1800-something, in 1810, 1820, thereabouts, the stethoscope was invented. And the stethoscope, as the word says, is stethoscope, you know, look inside the chest. And the whole vision about the stethoscope was, you know, can a clinician look inside the chest? And once you look inside the chest, you get a good view of the anatomy and you can actually diagnose a lot better. But unfortunately, until 2010, you know, until the V-scan came out, there was no device which could actually look inside the chest in a portable fashion. So you can see the power of it. This particular device that I showed you can fundamentally look at 80% of the anatomy. Just pause and think about it. You know, with this device, if you have the right user and the right trained clinician, you can look at basically everything below the neck. And that gives a humongous amount of power to a clinician who's diagnosing, you know, things related to the heart. Someone has right upper quadrant pain. Someone has, they have to look at the baby. You have to look at the bladder. You can look at the long bone fractures. I mean, the possibilities are large. And that's the power that V-scan gives a clinician.
You mentioned training. What kind of requirement of training does this have? Does for a nurse practitioner or a primary care physician or even somebody like a paramedic, how much required training do they have before they're able to interpret what they're looking at?
Yeah. So you know, there's three parts to the training. And I have to caveat all of this before, you know, by saying that the device as is right now, the label says it has to be used under the supervision of a clinician, okay? So it has to be, typically we say that, you know, a doctor has to be around. So a nurse practitioner, if they're using it, they have to be under the supervision of a doctor. Now the training itself, there is one part of the training which is knowing the anatomy. And if you're a clinician, you know the anatomy. So that's a check, okay? The second part of this device, and which is unique to ultrasound, is if you look at this probe, this has to be placed properly. Whatever you're doing, a carotid, you're doing a coronary, you're looking a heart, whatever it is, you have to place it properly. So getting the scan plane is the second part of the training. And the third then, when you get the scan plane, you know, this is all about saying whether there is a pathology or there is no pathology. So that's the third part. You know, how do you look at a ultrasound image, which is in two dimensions, and correlate that to a pathology that a patient might have? Those are the three things. Now, in terms of duration of training, there's a lot of data for that. You know, we have done training. There are external entities which have done training in places as far out as Ifakara in Tanzania, Indonesia, and as back, you know, close to home as Mayo Clinic and Mount Sinai and all that. You know, typically they say somewhere between six, you know, call it a week to 2 weeks is sufficient with respect to training to use a V-scan. And in some cases, it's even been less. We did some training at UPMC in Pittsburgh, and in a couple of days, the clinicians were up and running with respect to V-scan. So training is minimal. As you can see, this is very easy to use. You know, if you, I don't know if you can see the screen, but compared to a regular ultrasound, all you have is one of these iPod kinds of you know, circular buttons here that you can change the settings with. So very simple to use.
How about the capabilities of power or diagnostic capability? How does it compare to a full-size unit?
Yeah, so the kinds of things. So I think, you know, if you look at it, first question is what can you scan and what can you not scan? So if you see here, there is one part which is called a linear probe, which is for superficial anatomies, higher frequency, you know, 7 megahertz, 6 megahertz kind of a frequency. So with that, you can look at superficial things. You know, you have small parts, you've got carotids, you've got, you know, deep vein thrombosis, lungs, you can look at the lungs as well, that you can do with this. Now, the difference between this and a $200,000 device is that you cannot, you know, have a multitude of probes. So if you look at a large device, you can change the probe out and say, you know, I want to go 12 megahertz. And that really focuses on looking at, you know, someone having rheumatoid arthritis, for example, really at the surface. You know, those kinds of things, so you cannot be that specialized with this product. Furthermore, the way the product is tuned, in ultrasound, there's something called a preset, okay, which is how do you tune the device? It's like your camera. You know, before you take a picture, you change the aperture, you'll change the contrast, all those kinds of things, right? Similarly, if you take a high-cost device, you can tune it extremely well. This one, we have tuned it for you, and there's a few set cases that you do press, you know, plug and play. Now, one side of that is, you know, it's easier for someone who's not a deep kind of sonographer who's trained in the art over years. So some of those specialized kinds of, you know, scans, if you want to do an echo, it doesn't have a Doppler, for example. It has color, but it doesn't have a Doppler. So if you want to do specialized scans, you will always revert back to a standard device, a larger device. But this is great for what it's supposed to do. It's supposed to triage. It's the front end, figure what the problem is, and then move the patient to the risk-appropriate setting. So that's sort of the difference, and that's how you should think of it.
It sounds fantastic, and I like looking at the device. You're right, it's so compact, it's hard to believe that you've been able to shrink all those capabilities down into something so small and easy to handle.
Yeah. No, I think there's a lot of electronics, you know, as you can imagine, a lot of miniaturization from an engineering standpoint. When you put so many miniaturized circuits in a small box, there is a question of heat management. I mean, this thing throws out a lot of heat. So how do you manage all of that? And we manage it, and this is where I think creative engineers and quality engineers come in. We don't even have a fan in this. You know, you remember the Mac devices, for example. That's the beauty of the management. You have to manage it well with respect to power and do the right trade-offs. So, I think this is one of a kind. I think we're very proud of it.
Yeah, our show's aimed primarily at nurses, and as we see more and more advanced practice nurses entering the primary care field as standalone providers in many states without physician oversight, what are some of the things that GE Primary Care is doing at this time to reach out to some of these non-traditional primary care resources?
That's one more great question, and especially as healthcare evolves in this nation, as well as elsewhere, every place you go, well-trained clinicians are becoming more and more scarce. And so as we progress, as you and I go into our, golden years, if you will, 20, 30 years from now, a lot of healthcare will happen at the edge with maybe not, full-blown doctors. And so I think the question we ask in primary care is, how do you do what is called as distributed healthcare? And it, I think, hinges on a whole host of things. And these are the kinds of things you can imagine we're doing in the lab and working with clinicians in defining. So one theme is, we all know digital health and cloud is here, right? So how can we leverage the cloud to make analyses or maybe do the scans on the front end and then somehow ship those scans over the internet to a back office which has a little bit more capabilities, make the diagnosis there, and send the results out to the edge? So those are the kinds of things we're thinking of. We're also thinking of taking this device and making it even more miniature. This is still, it's great, we're happy, but you look at your iPhone and we have a long way to go. You look at the interface here, this interface is, we're happy with it, but still it's not the touch interface that people are used to nowadays. So those are the kinds of things we are putting into this so that, consumers, and these are not, hardcore consumers. These are, still trained clinicians, in some cases, midwives, for example. People who are not doctors can start using it. And a great example is, we are doing some work in Ghana, and some of these places, sitting in New York, it's tough to get a good feel for it, but, the maternal mortality and infant mortality is so high, and devices like this are purported to make a big difference to those numbers. So that's those are some of the places where primary care and ultrasound intersect.
It's certainly amazing when you think about all the types of miniature diagnostic tools that have come into the marketplace, and the V-Scan is certainly one of them. I want to thank you so much for taking some time out of your busy day to talk with the Nursing Show audience and share this innovative new tool that could be something we see in our offices coming up here soon, will help us handle patients better and manage illnesses and get patients to the right care that they need from a frontline position.
Yeah. We at GE Healthcare share that vision, and Jamie, it's been a pleasure talking to you.